Good morning. Thank you for the introduction. As he said, my name is Eric Dehoff, and I'm a chief engineer and technical leader for CE at Honda R&D in Americas. I started Honda over 20 years ago and the first and only CA group in the company. We did everything from aviation durability to crash to even aerodynamics. Now there are expert users scattered throughout the company specializing in these areas. My presentation today entitled Bringing Reality into the Virtual World will give an overview of how we are creating models and analyzing simulation results using these tools from beta CE and potentially where these tools need to go. So since I am from the US, I figured I'd give you a little background on what we do. We have production facilities and R&D facilities all over the US, North America actually, some in Canada, some in Mexico. But the main vehicle development center is located in central Ohio, about 3 hours south of Detroit. It's the second largest employer in the state of Ohio behind the government. Our campus, you see there on the right, holds about 2,000 associates, has its own prototype fabrication area, 40% scale wind tunnel, and a crash barrier, where we do about 80% of our own crash tests in the building. So Honda R&D has been in Ohio for about 30 years. We started by developing derivative models, like making a four-door Accord and turning it into a wagon or a two-door. Over the years, we grew to making unique cars like the Acura TL and Honda Element off of the Japanese vehicle platforms. Finally, we made our own light truck platform where we started creating Honda and Acura vehicles that are now sold throughout the world. Our North American mobility efforts expand well outside of automobiles. We also develop off-road ATVs, and actually we make a business jet. So give a little more background into our world. I'm showing you a typical vehicle development schedule. It might look similar to all the other automotive OEMs out there. Early on, we set performance targets that we want this car to meet, as well as any of the regulations that the car needs to meet to be sold. There are several gates where design groups issue data that can be used to build models and do analysis of all types. The time between these gates is measured in weeks, with the longest section being about 10 weeks, which makes building models quickly very important. The results are judged against the list of targets requirements I mentioned, and they're reported to a technical group that we have that none of them are CE experts. They're engineers, but they're not CE experts. So communicating these results to these non-experts is very important. So now let's get into the model building a little bit. And I'm going to talk about our crash models because, that's my background. And we've been working hard over the last 20 years to make them as accurate and predictive as possible. Our goal is to predict the outcome of the physical test in all aspects. And since no other CE people are here from Ohio that can argue with me, I will say that our crash models are the most detailed and complicated full vehicle models we build during development. We build one detailed model for all structural crash modes that promotes consistently, at least when we start. So we build one model, it goes out to the separate groups, they do the analysis, and then it does change depending on the mode. So I mentioned before how we're trying to make our models predictive. So here I'm showing some of the examples of the kind of details we put into the model. We have material properties to predict fracture in the body and the chassis parts so we can get the correct loading through the structure. Detailed joint modeling, whether through 3D bolts or spot weld failure, and more details are being added all the time for fuel and electrical systems so that we can actually make sure that we protect them from damage. Of course, this detail comes at a price in model size and complexity, which is difficult to deal with. Pre-processing, post-processing, solving, it all adds up to slow down the process. So how has the model building changed over the years? The first body model we built took a long time to create. We only had 3D wireframe geometry, and that was because it was easier for designers to produce paper drawings with wireframe. The CA group took that wireframe, we had to surface it, we had to mesh it, and then we were attaching connections node to node by hand. We had drawings laid out on our tables. We'd mark each weld off with a highlighter to make sure that we got them all. And that took four of us 4 months to create that first model. And this was probably about 2000 that we did that. I'll be honest, it was an awful job. I don't miss it a bit. So today, with better geometry, with the models, the CAD tools, and then the tools available on ANSA, we have actually just one person build a body model in less than 2 weeks, even including the detail I mentioned with all the detailed connections. He's a special person, by the way. He's probably the best tool we have in the company. So how do we do this? First, it starts with the better information from our designers. Of course, they've improved CAD over the years. It started them, now they're designing in solids and surfaces instead of just lines. We worked with them over the years to put more data or specs into their CAD. So when we used to get the information, the CE guys would have to log in to the CAD or pull up the drawing to get the material, the thickness and everything off the drawing. Or we'd call up the designer and say, hey, what's the material? What's the thickness of this? Now that they put those into the CAD, we can just automatically download those. And we don't have to have as many questions. But once that CAD was produced, the CE people would have to go in, log into the CAD system, download all the information into a file, and then load it into ANSA. We've worked with our IT people, so now when we ask them to, they will dump all that data into the file system for us overnight. So we do not have to log into the CAD system at all anymore. So that's been a really big benefit and a time saver. And then all this information is available. We load it right into ANSA with all the parts tree, the position, the material thickness is automatically imported. Saved us 3 to 4 days per model build. So we've also worked with Beta C, developed some scripts to help us apply failure to our spot welds. Of course, the built-in connection manager can realize these detailed welds. I think you saw some of these yesterday where you can put the weld in with the heat affected zone around it. And we do use mesh-dependent welds now because of our mesh size being so small. But with this script, we can apply weld failure to roughly the 5,000 welds in the car in a matter of minutes. And it goes through a lookup table, and the weld failures applied based on material thickness of the stack up. But it takes just a few minutes to get through every weld in the vehicle. Some other groups have been working also with Beta CE recently, developed some more tools. Our engine group worked with Beta CE to develop a better way to model MIG welds that are used in thermal analysis. The previous preprocessors they were using couldn't get a conformal mesh that reduced the accuracy of the results that were coming out. You can kind of see the difference between the before and the after pictures, but don't ask me why the after is better. I don't know. I have to trust that it is. This video is playing is the one of the newest tools we developed with Beta CE. It's a 3D bolt modeling tool. So, you know, if you've been in the CE world long enough, you know all the detail that gets added, your mesh size gets finer. That adds to more detail in every joint. So it just keeps spiraling down and down, adding more detail. So when we go to add more detail, we found that some of the joints, when we represent a bolt with a spider or a beam, just wasn't transferring the load correctly through the joint. So we've been having to add more 3D bolts in our model. With the help of this tool, we can take the CAD, mesh the 3D bolt, it'll create the contacts, it'll make a pre-stress so we can get the clamp load, and also make a section force so we can measure all the bolt forces in it. So it's been really helpful, and we can create a lot of 3D bolts very quickly using this tool. So now we know how to create all these parts and all these connections. So how do we tie the whole vehicle together? Basically, we create these automatic connections through the use of GEBs. Basically, these are the similar types of connections that we use in every vehicle. So where the chassis, the doors, closure, other closures, sunroof, all kind of go in the same place. We have standard connections. That reduces the chance for our model people to miss a connection. So it's easily run this and tie all these parts together. So this is what it looks like. Obviously we use include files, and so now that we're have all the connections and materials and model ready to go, we do the final assembly just like in the car. We have another script that helps set up the modes, whether it's front, side, crash. We can pick powertrain, we can pick mode, and it pulls out the correct list of correct files from our list of include files to apply to the model, and then they all get assembled, and each group can run their own models. Sounds pretty easy when I do it in a PowerPoint, and actually it is a lot easier now with the tools in ANSA. It's a lot easier than it used to be in the past. So just kind of summarizing what it is in the model build process, with the ANSA tools, it's become easier and more efficient over the years to make a model. This has given us, at least Honda North America, the ability to build models in-house and control the process better and be more flexible as issues arise. So we do not outsource any model building. We build everything in-house. We build probably 12 models a year, which doesn't sound like a lot, but when there's only 12 months, you can believe we're kind of busy every day. It also gives us the flexibility to add new features as we go along or change versions of ANSA a lot easier, so we don't have to deal with outsource companies. So now let's switch to looking at results that come from these models we just built. So a vehicle test can generate thousands of data points, whether it comes from sensors in the vehicle or the crash dummy, or even points in the car that we measure deformation on body components. But obviously the model can generate millions of data points at each node and element, from stress and strain to displacement and acceleration. So how can we analyze all this available data smartly and efficiently? If you couldn't guess, MetaPost is the main tool we use to analyze and compare these all these results. So, in the, as I mentioned before, we deal a lot with non-CAE experts. So they're used to seeing physical test results. So it's really important for us to compare the CAE results to test results to help determine the accuracy and to prove to these people that these models are correct. We use both visual and numerical means to compare the data. When I mean visual, I mean animations and deformations. And we also use numerical, which again is plot after plot after plot of data. So you always got to do, as everybody says, the eye test. If it looks right animation, then you believe your plots are right. If it doesn't look right in the animation, your plot still agrees, you still are skeptical. So you have to use both to make sure of what your model's predicting. As I mentioned, again, we can produce millions of nodal and element locations. Animations of the entire model or critical parts can be made, obviously, on the fly while you're in MetaPost. But we also create preset measurement points for different modes using, again, GEB in a config file. So then you can, when you create these, different skill or different levels of analysts can generate the same exact results, and so that it's a consistent look when the results come out. And we also use those config files to create automatic reports for pretty much every mode in crash. Durability makes some also some reports. The groups are slowly, other groups are slowly building these reports. So during a test, we take a lot of camera views. Some test engineers are crazier than others and use every camera we have in the building, but you can see this is an example of things. It's really good from a test, but you know, you're limited to this during a test. I mean, once the test happens, you can't zoom in, you can't rotate, you're stuck with these views, which again is good for us. CAE, we can match those views relatively easy, but that's what we're stuck with those views. So Again, MetaPost has some great tools. These are very old videos that I have, but it has great tools to overlay model and simulation results. I'm not sure why that other one's not playing, but it shows the same thing. But we can overlay them, and it's easier. Now we can compare each one of those views to the video. But we need to do it a little more efficiently. I mean, using maybe a standard view setup or something that we can kind of do it in batch mode, that we could compare all these views together. So like as I said, when we share these results outside the CAE world, it's important to give the audience the confidence that what they are seeing is real. So when these non-experts see the picture that you see there, they don't really believe it because it looks like a cartoon. It looks fake. So the immediate perception of the results aren't correct because it doesn't look like a physical test. So today the most popular movies employ computer-generated characters and objects that look realistic, so CG is very popular. So I worked with a company a few years ago to render our crash models with realistic materials and lighting. We do this for media events and car shows to explain to the public our safety for everyone's story. The change in people's perception of the results was immediate. It, you know, gave instant credibility to the model, especially when you tell them what is behind the model. With all the material testing, the physical testing that goes into the model, it's a physics-based simulation, not just a animation like a movie person created. However, this process does take a lot of time, so we can't use it every day, and actually the CAE engineer doesn't really need to use it every day. They can do their job with the painted model. However, as you hear over and over, every company is moving to a virtual type solution or virtual development. And we're using more and more of the computer model to make judgments. We don't want to build cars as much anymore. So as we go to these technical events and explain these results to people, non-CAE people, I should say, we need to convince them that this is right. And we struggle with this every day. One day they believe the model, the next day they don't. It just depends on the day. So to eliminate that, we need to do something like realistic rendering for each of these technical gates. So it's great that MetaPost has put it inside inside a MetaPost so that we can have the ability to render on a more regular basis. And hopefully this helps convince those people that our model is correct. And then of course there's VR. You've seen it yesterday, seeing it more and more. We actually have VR being used in AeroThere's, our company, to simulate interior styling options, ingress, egress checks, and some ergonomic issues. The potential to use VR to explore CAE results could grow. As I mentioned, the realistic colors and lighting changes the way you view things. If we added another dimension from 2D to 3D, so in other words, being immersed in the model, does it help? I don't know. We're going to try. We think it will. We've kind of demoed this in what we call a fuel certification event. So when we check our fuel systems through the model, it's a bunch of snapshots, pictures, section cuts, some animations, but again, it's still 2D. So we think what we did was we pulled up the model and we put the VR on and we were inside the fuel system and looking at things all around. You could turn your head and see what was happening, and the evaluators of that really liked it. So right now we're trying to figure out how to do that a little more mainstream and apply it into our development. Some other potential uses for VR. I'd love to put people in the driver's seat during a crash. Nobody volunteers very regularly. Some of our co-ops might. No. This would be a perfect use for the model. So we have an occupant model. We actually have this VR buck, so our interior buck. You see it's kind of plain, but it has a seat, steering wheel, door. Put that person in the driver's seat with a VR headset and put the occupant model in there and see how scared they get when the airbag comes out. But we're gonna try this here in the near future. gives you a whole new perspective from the model and again from the test video. So finally, for the summary of results, obviously the Metapost tools, the CE versus has some really good, Metapost has some really good tools for visualizing results and overlaying CE and test. Again, the key to all this is to make it easy and efficient for the users to use these tools. All right, so where do we need to go in the future with ANSA and Meta? First of all, the interface needs to be updated a little bit. I think somebody mentioned it yesterday. When you're training new users, it's a little intimidating when you open it up. So can we make it a little cleaner and fresh? It's good for experienced users. It's a great tool. And once you get it, it's great. But like I said, it's a little intimidating to new users. So in Ohio, almost all of our CE groups are now moving to ANSA. So almost everybody in the company will be using ANSA here soon. When that transition is complete, we'd like to target maybe one ANSA database for all models, including some of the multiphysics models. The question I still have is whether or not this is more efficient. It takes us, you know, four weeks to 5 weeks to build a crash model. Can we build an NVH model at the same time? Can we build a durability model at the same time? Can we build all the models within a five-week span? If it gets longer than that, then somebody's waiting. They're losing analysis time. So I don't know right now if it's more efficient, but I think if we could build everything from one consistent set of data in maybe a four-week period, maybe it will be. As you just heard, my colleague from Japan, IGA is the future. I think there's great potential in it. The problem we have now is kind of circular as always. We need to prove out the method, whether it's right, but it's difficult to build a model. A lot of companies, software companies, don't want to put effort into supporting that until we've committed to that. So again, I appreciate ANSA's work in starting this. So now we can build models, we can test out the theory as we go along and prove that this is a good way. I think another problem with IG right now is there's competing technology. You've heard there's B splines, U splines, NURBS patches, solids versus shells. I can't tell you which one's best until I build a model. We got to work together. We got to work together to build these models. And then again, as I said, I've spent 20 years proving, and I still prove it every day, that my method is right. I got to do that again with IGA. I'm starting over. So it's going to be difficult, but I think it's a good direction to go. Just touching again on the rendering. We need a better material library, but that's on us. As a user, we will develop our own material library. I think we need to work somehow to set up some standard camera views. Batch rendering would be great so that we could submit it and the model comes back the next day rendered. And again, carrying this realistic rendering into the VR world obviously would be also very good and very powerful. And I think I heard some of that yesterday, the thing. So some of my questions are already being answered. topology to CAD. Another big push that we'll have is the area of topology optimization. Again, Beta C has developed some of the tools in ACP op design, which is a great start. The thing we have to consider is this tool, topology optimization, may end up in designers' hands, not CAE people's hands. So we have to be careful make sure that, you know, we work on the same terminology or the same tools that, again, designers understand and CE people understand. So finally, to summarize my high-level look at simulation, I just want to say that Beta CAE has developed some excellent tools in their future direction. Seems to match the direction of at least the automotive industry needs. Trying to bring more reality in the virtual world by creating highly detailed models are starting to cause issues in handling the models on a daily basis and trying to parse through all the results that come back. Visualization is key in communicating the results to everyone, especially in the future with new types of simulation being developed due to electrification and autonomous vehicles. as most of you know, the virtual world changes very fast. So hopefully the tools can keep up with what we're trying to do. Thank you for your attention.